or to be fed. And that's what that ministry does. He also has an orphanage of 100 children, and they take care of these children that have been abandoned by their parents, or even in some cases, when the mother in the village and outside of the village is giving birth, the umbilical cord has to be cut with some archaic way, and the mother dies, and they take the children. Many Indians have been persecuted, and oftentimes leading to death, and they take the children. And it's an excellent ministry. He's also a church planter. He has a ministry team, and they go out into the villages, they go into the city, they preach the gospel, they lead people to Christ, and it's a deliverance ministry. People are set free, demons are cast out. It's a wonderful ministry. And for the past month, this man has been here at Mount Zion House, and he's been sharing in our ministry, teaching the men, spending time with the men, working alongside the men. And he has a burden for the lost, the hurting, and for those who have addictions, as well as just those who need to know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Pastor Sinapati is going to be leaving and going back to India tomorrow. And tonight we are blessed to be able to hear what God is going to use him for, and that's to preach the gospel message in Daniel. Pastor Sinapati, would you please come forward? Please give him a hand.
Thank you so much. Thank God that God has given me this golden opportunity to share the word of God before you. I'm so privileged, and I'm very, very honored to be over here. I did not expect that in this great church, I could preach over here the word of God. Yeah, I don't know what should I preach, because my mouth and my lips are drying. It is not just because of I'm thirsty, but I'm getting a little nervous. Okay, let's have a word of prayer. Dear loving, gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this beautiful day you had given to us. We thank you so much for this fellowship. We thank you so much for this congregation, the beautiful church you have given to us, my God. We thank you so much for the beautiful and the great spirit-filled your servants you have given to this congregation. Lord, now we're going to read from this Bible, Daniel chapter 4. We don't know anything, but you can teach us. You can guide us with the Holy Spirit, my God. Help us to open our ear to hear. Help us to open our hearts and minds to understand your deep meaning of the word, my God. We are nothing before you, but you can teach us through your words, my God, your eternal word. We thank you so much that you are being here. We seek your presence. We seek your guidance. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Please open your Bible with me, because I used to all the time, I'm a person to showing the scripture all the time. So be ready. And I know that you are the spirit-filled person, and you are this church is, I see the church like a barrier. The book of Acts says that, the barrier. So you are searching all the scripture. So anyways, I don't want to go the backward or the history of Daniel chapter 4 or about Daniel or Nebuchadnezzar. So I would like to go very short, and whatever given me that assignments or task to say about the Daniel chapter 4. So it is verse 1. 1, 2, 3, can anybody can read, please, for me, so that you can understand? Or Mike, can you help me, please? Thank you so much. Here we see that Nebuchadnezzar, the king, he was a heathen king. First of all, we have to know that he was a heathen king. And his kingdom is an everlasting kingdom. There is no definite article in the original language. So it reads, a son of God, that is, an angel or a superhuman being. Nebuchadnezzar could not have known that New Testament revelation of the Son of God, who was born of God and Mary, Matthew chapter 1, verse 18 to 23, and Luke chapter 1, 35, and Hebrews 1, 5 to 7. Note that he himself acknowledged that being was an angel in verse 28. So here we see that the heathen king, Nebuchadnezzar, he's confessing that because he has previously last Wednesday, we heard already last Wednesday about the story about the Daniel and his friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So how he was speaking about the testimony, chapter Daniel chapter 3, verse 27, and the satraps, administrators, governors, and the king's counselors gathered together, and they saw them men on whose bodies are fire and no power. The hair of their head was no singed, nor were their garments affected, and the smell of fire was not on them. But we can see that verse here too. He's proclaiming the heathen king, Nebuchadnezzar, he's proclaiming. I thought, verse 2, it's good to declare the signs and wonders that he has seen. He has experienced in his life that he has seen the signs and wonders that Most High God has worked for me. That means he's testifying. He's giving testimony. So then verse 3 says that, how great are his signs and how mighty his wonders. His kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and his dominion is from generation to generation. That here we see that the king Nebuchadnezzar, he's acknowledged that the two great things, Nebuchadnezzar, a heathen king, expressed two great doctrines of scripture that very few Bible scholars understand or acknowledge today. Number one is that God's kingdom is to be everlasting one. And verse two, and number two is that eternal generations of natural people will be on the earth. There are the two things he's understanding over here, verse 3. And verse 2, verse 1, he says that to all peoples, nations, and languages, that doesn't mean that the whole world. The Bible says about there is the Daniel's second promotion of the three Hebrew companies of Daniel, that we see that is the all the earth under Nebuchadnezzar, not all the earth outside his kingdom, which included only the modern states of Palestine, Transjordan, Syria, Egypt, Lebanon, Iraq, and Iran. The phrase all the earth must be understood in a limited sense as explained of the limitations of the Antichrist's kingdom. That we can see that. And verse 4 to verse 7, we see that he's moving the place, and he's proclaiming himself that about the dreams, and he's giving the chance. Verse 7, 6, 7, 8, we see that he's giving, this is the second dreams. The second dreams of Nebuchadnezzar, that he's having dreams about the prophetic tree vision. And he called the second time also, he is giving time and opportunity to all the magician, all the astrologers, the Chaldeans, and the soothsayers came in, and I, the soothsayer, told them the dream, but they did not make known to me its interpretation. Verse 8 said that, but at last Daniel came before me. His name is Belteshazzar, according to the name of my God. In him is the spirit of holy God. And I told the dream before him, saying, so that means here, Belteshazzar means may Bel protect his life. So he's giving the chance, and the second time also the people the wise men at the time, the soothsayers, they were failed. They could not interpret or translate the dreams of the king Nebuchadnezzar. Then here we see 8:9 says that the Holy Spirit is telling, he's confessing the Holy Spirit is or was in the life of or in Daniel. But we see the Belteshazzar is again saying, verse 8, at last Daniel came before me. His name is Belteshazzar. According to the name of my God, in him is the spirit of the Holy God. He knows that the Holy God, the Almighty One, is with him. And told the dream before me, saying, verse 9, Belteshazzar, chief of the magicians, because I know that the spirit of the God is in you, and no secret troubles you. Explain to me the visions of my dream that I have seen and its interpretation. So this is the saying, this is a great conversation with a great man of God, Daniel, and King Nebuchadnezzar. And verse 10 onwards, we can see that he's saying his dreams. Verse from 10 to 16, we see the prophet, he's telling his people, or to Daniel, the prophetic vision, that it is written here, verse 10, these were the visions of my head while on my bed. I was looking, and behold, a tree in the midst of the earth, and its height was great. The tree grew and became strong. Its height reached to the heavens, and it could be seen to the ends of all the earth. Verse 12, its leaves were lovely, its fruit abundant, and in it was food for all. The beasts of the field found shade under it. The birds of the heavens dwelt in its branches, and all flesh was fed from it. Verse 13, I saw in the visions of my head while on my bed, and there was a watcher, a holy one coming down from heaven. He cried out, he cried aloud and said thus, chop down the tree and cut off its branches, stripe off its leaves and scatter its fruit. Let the beasts get out from under it and the birds from its branches. Nevertheless, leave the stump and roots in the earth, bound with the band of iron and bronze in the tender grass of the field. Let it be weighed with the dew of the heaven, and let him graze with the beast on the grass on the earth. Verse 16, let his heart be changed from that of a man. Let him be given the heart of a beast, and let seven times pass over him. This is up to 16. This is his dream he's proclaiming, he's telling to the servant of God, Daniel, we see here. So what does it mean? I understand that here, the tree is known as the great men are often compared to trees. Great men are often compared to trees. The king Nebuchadnezzar was a great man, and God wants to show the vision, and God wants to do, or he wants to deal with something special about the kingdom. The tree, that means I can understand from my childhood about the Mother Teresa. You might have heard that Mother Teresa, my brothers and sisters, about the American great guy, Reverend Martin Luther King, they had a dream. Is not it? Mahatma Gandhi, the father of India, father of our nation, of my nation, that he had a dream, non-violence dream, so that I can set free the India with the non-violence from the British rule. Anyway, so that's why Mother Teresa had a dream to serve the poor people. I don't know whether you have heard the story or not. But before 15 days or 20 days before she died, she was admitted to hospital. She was ridden in sick bed in the hospital, Calcutta, one of the city of India. And she died. She says it's her testimony. I read it, many people, they know that. I don't know, you might have also known that. that she died, and afterward then she went to heaven. And in heaven, she met some disciples like Peter, John, and other people, and they told to her, why did you come here? There is no sick people over here. There is no wounded people. There is no any diseased people over here. You go back and you serve on the earth. Afterward, then she came alive, and she told to many of her colleagues or her staff or brothers and sisters or many people. And afterward, 15 days, she died, my dear brothers. So just I would like to go to quickly. So the great men are often compared to trees. You see your America, for example, the great George Washington. When the British army, they were running after him to catch him, that he, with a great God, God's spirit was with him, George Washington. And with his army man, with his colleagues, he jumped. They jumped into the cold water. And they crossed the river, and they erected the flags of United States of America. These are the dreams. So likewise, he has a dream, and this great man, God has given the kingdom to Nebuchadnezzar, and it is come by the kingdom, or the nation is coming, the will of God. And we can see that Nebuchadnezzar is having a dream, and this is the second dream. And that here, so but afterward, then verse, I just jump here, the verse 17 here, the decision is by the decree of the watchers, and the sentence by the word of the holy ones, in order that the living may know that the Most High rules in the kingdom of man, gives it to whomever he will, and sets over it the lowest of the man. We see here, and verse 16, that God wants to change. God wants to change his heart, the heart of Nebuchadnezzar. This is the one kind of a disease called lycanthropy. Lycanthropy means the man becoming like a wolf or like a bear or like animal. He's changing. He's changing himself. I have seen in India, I don't know, I can give testimony through this. I want a little break. In India, a man has, in India, we discriminate many people, Hindu people, they discriminate the girl child. And a Christian family, they were also expected 3, 4, 5, 6, afterward, seventh will be, hopefully God will give us a male child. Then afterwards, they were the great men of faith, and they did not went for or go for checkup or sonography to what is coming to be. So, but later on, at last, she bore, the wife bore a child, girl child also, seventh girl child. Later, they were so disappointed. This is when I was reading this, that's why I'm just thinking about my story in India, what happened. After that, the girl child, she grew up to 7, 8, and ultimately they were praying the whole family, praying, and because of a disappointment of the seventh girl child, but the girl child also grew up, and when she grew up, at the age of 7 or 8, she automatically transferred into male child that I have seen with my eyes, my dear brothers. So likewise, anyway, she changed into female or girl to boy. But here he's changing, it is called the lycanthropy. And let his heart be, verse 16, let his heart be changed from that of a man. Let him be given the heart of a beast. The heart is changing. Heart is changing. And after that, the man of God, Daniel, is proclaiming that and the watcher, verse 17, the decision is by the decree of the watcher. Watcher means here could be angel or could be the superhuman being. The superhuman being is coming down from heaven, and he's proclaiming the sentence by the word, holy ones, in order that the living man know that the Most High rules in the kingdom of man, gives it to whomsoever he will, and sets over it the lowest of the man. This is the all, everything comes from the Lord. And the spirit of the verse 18, he's proclaiming the king This is the dream I, King Nebuchadnezzar, have seen. Now you, Belteshazzar, declare its interpretation, since all the wise men of my kingdom are not able to make known to me the interpretation, but you are able, for the spirit of the Holy God is in you. My dear brothers, my dear sisters, my dear father and mother, let's see that the Holy Spirit, the spirit of the Holy God is in you. It was the great power that inspired to Daniel. It was a great power, the Holy Spirit encouraged and given wisdom. We can't without, till now also, till today, many wise men in this world or on this earth, many wise men, intelligent person, we can't able to understand the deep meaning of this prophet book of Daniel. But here, God, the Holy Spirit is helping him to interpret. So when verse 19, then Daniel, whose name was Belteshazzar, was astonished for a time, and his thoughts troubled him. So the king spoke, he said, Belteshazzar, do not let the dream or its interpretation trouble you. Belteshazzar answered and said, my lord, may the dream concern those who hate you, and its interpretation concerns your enemies. Here we see that Daniel's compassionate alarm at the coming calamity. And he's proclaiming that he's thinking, many people, many wise people at that time, they took many days to interpret this vision or the dreams of Nebuchadnezzar king. But within 1 hour, we can see that he's thinking, he's speaking out and he's thinking. He's thinking and he's replying within 1 hour that, my lord, may the dream concern those who hate you. Who is hating to the king? Nobody's hate. If the enemies is there, would be there, they would have killed him. That was no enemy. But it is the man of God or the angel he's talking about. So verse 20, the tree that you saw, that he's interpreting, the tree that you saw, which grew and became strong, whose height reached to the heavens, and which could be seen by all the earth, whose leaves were lovely, and its fruit abundant, in which was food for all, under which the beasts of the field dwelt, and in whose branches the birds of the heaven and their home. That means we see here the trees, the great men are often compared to trees. That means we can see, could you read please, Matthew chapter 7. I would like to ask you, or I can read for you, 7, verse 17 to 19, Jesus Christ speaking about trees. 7 verse 7, 17, 18, 19. Even so, every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, nor can a bad tree bear good fruit. Verse 19. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. We see that Jesus Christ is comparing to the human being or the man as a tree. We can see that. And Daniel is interpreting that, no, my master, my majesty, that is you. That tree is you. And you grew up. God is giving the tree that you saw, which grew and become strong. Ezekiel chapter 17, verse 5 to 6, also you can find out the same God's word, and you can see. And your most famous verse, you can find out that you might have known by heart, Psalm chapter 1, verse 3. It's very beautifully written. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that brings forth its fruit in its season, whose leaf also shall not wither, and whatever he does shall prosper. Psalm chapter 1, verse 3. And Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 8 also says that, so this is the man are compared, great men are compared to the trees. And he's talking, and let's see that afterward, then verse 23 there, and inasmuch as the king saw a watcher, a holy one, coming down from heaven and saying, chop down the tree and destroy it, but leave its stump and roots in the earth, bound with a band of iron and bronze in the tender grass of the field. Let it be wet with the dew of heaven, and let him graze with the beasts of the field till seven times pass over him. These seven times, many people, they understand that very differently, because Second Kings chapter 5, verse 19-20 or 10, they interpret the dipping in the water, Naaman dipping into the water in the Jordan, the river Jordan. So like this, the people, they say like that, but he's a seven times, that means 7 years. This 7 years is recognized or symbolized the seven very difficult time, very critical time. You see, so verse 24, this is the interpretation, O king, and this is the decree of the Most High, which has come upon my lord, the king. They shall drive you from man. Your dwelling shall be with the beasts of the field, and they shall make you eat grass like oxen. They shall wait you. This again, there's interpreting the same verse, the same words. And now we see the verse 26. And inasmuch as they gave the command to leave the stump and roots of the tree, your kingdom shall be assured to you after you come to know that heaven rules. You see, 7 years he's becoming beast. He's sounding, or he can't speak. He's sounding like a bear or something animal. And verse 26, there the stamp was left out. That means no king was chosen in his stead. In his place, there was no king chosen in the 7 years. Maybe, or it could be his son, his regent, his own regent son could have protected, and his people could have protected his kingdom. Verse 27, therefore, O king, let my advice be acceptable to you. Break off your sins by being righteous, and your iniquities by showing mercy to the poor. Perhaps there may be a lengthening of your prosperity. We see that. Sometimes I come from India, and in Hindu people, they do a lot of, they get salvation. They get salvation by action. How is action is called? When they die, when father or mother die, or a brother or someone, his relative die, they chop, they become bald-headed. They color the hair also, and they go Ram Naam Satya Hai. That means four people, they carry the body, the last of the body, of the dead body, and they go. And they give they throw like anything, all the money to the people, and the poor people, they come and collect like that. Collect like this. If they give a glass of water to the poor people, they get salvation. If they give if they do not kill the ants or animal, they get salvation. So many way of. So that is here we see that he is being righteous. He's a heathen king, but he wants to be self-righteous. He has seen the miracle last two chapters. We saw that last three chapters, that he has seen with his eyes the God's miracle. God's miracle, but still he wants a self-righteousness. Self-righteousness. So that's why he's advising. How many secretaries of you, how many colleagues of you, if he or she tells you to stop it, don't do that. How many of us, the leaders, they stop the works, or they obey their secretaries or colleagues or clerk or accountant? Here we see that the great man of God, I love in it, that therefore, O king, he's giving advice. Let my advice be acceptable to you. And he's listening. So many things. Here we see. Verse 33 says that he stops speaking about Nebuchadnezzar's humiliation. He's proud. And he is himself glorifying himself. Verse 28-29 says that all this came upon King Nebuchadnezzar at the end of the 12 months. He was walking about the royal palace of Babylon. We see that God was so gracious and gave him 12 months to check himself from going insane, going to be crazy, to be become or to be beast. God is so gracious to check himself, to examine himself. Sometimes as a Christian, we don't want to check up ourselves. Sometimes we preach, but it is very difficult to practice in our daily life or in our family life, in our ministries. But here, God is so gracious, and it gave us 28, 29, that God is giving 12 months, means 1 year. God was so gracious and gave him 12 months to check himself from going insane. And verse 29, at the end of the 12 months, he was walking about the royal palace of Babylon. Verse 30, the king spoke saying, is it this great Babylon that I have built for a royal dwelling by my mighty power and for the honor of my majesty? He's glorifying himself. Is not this great Babylon that I have built for a royal dwelling? Though he has seen the miracle, great wonder and signs of God through his servants, but still he is not recognized to God from his heart. He's boasting himself. He's glorifying himself. Many of us, my dear, we see that. Many of us in India or in the world, around the world, oh, my prayer tower is so much big. My church is so big. Oh, my. That means this noun goes, I have done. Sometimes we do that. Many prayer towers. Oh, Jesus calls prayer tower in Dallas. Or, XYZ, Jerusalem. Jerusalem, we're coming to Jesus Christ. There only one. So many things are there. We're best boasting. This is the king, Nebuchadnezzar. He's saying that in his heart, he has seen the miracle, but he did not submissive his heart to the Lord. I have made this great palace for my majesty, for my honor, glorifying himself. I don't want to take more time, but I want to go quick. But here 31, there says that while the word was still in the king's mouth, a voice fell from heaven, King Nebuchadnezzar, to you it is spoken, the kingdom has departed from you. And while he was speaking, he is departing. The kingdom is departing. He is going away. He is going to be insane or crazy. Insane? Is it crazy? I'm not. Crazy. Thank you. So here we see that he's going to them. While he was speaking, he's glorifying himself that I have made for the Babylon, that still he is going. And God's word is coming and speaking to, and he's departing from a separating man. Anyway, verse 32, and they shall drive you from man, and your dwelling shall be with the beast of the field. They shall make you eat grass like oxen. 7 times shall pass over you. 7 times, 7 times, again and again, 3, 4 times again. 7 times, 7 years, my dear brothers and sisters. 7 times. But God is so gracious to him, we can learn from him. After 7 years also, he's regaining, restored his blessing as it was. Okay, so anyways, so he is becoming the lycanthropy, a disease called lycanthropy, and he's becoming a beast. If you 73, verse 22, we are reading Psalm chapter 70. Can you read 73? The mic or 73, verse 22. I was like a beast. Here we see the 73, verse 22. I was so foolish and ignorant, I was like a beast before you. Many of us were coming to the church. Many people were very often, many, many times going to crusade, Bible college, but still, are we changed? We are not changed. Still, our arrogant and foolish, we are living like a beast. We are not, people are saying, looking at us, not like beast, but inside, whatever our activities, our words, our thoughts are like beast, my brother. Here we see that he is having the big lycanthropy disease, and he's going and becoming, the crazy in India. If you come, maybe Pastor John LaGalbo has seen that many crazy people, beggars are lying, their shaggy hair, their nails are unkept nails, and looking dirty, like beast. You can't even touch to them or can't speak to them also. But anyway, but Mother Teresa did good job in India. She went when the age of 17 years old from Albania, and she went. Anyways, but here we see that, verse 33, again, I would like to repeat and read it. The very hour the word was fulfilled concerning, the fulfilling about the about his promised dreams and exactly interpreting of Daniel. The very hour the word was fulfilled concerning Nebuchadnezzar, he was driven from man and ate grass like oxen. His body was wet with the dew of heaven till his hair had grown like eagle's feathers and his nails like bird's claws. We can see there, he's becoming totally the crazy or insanity. So we can see that he's becoming. So anyways, but still, God is giving time. And verse 34 to 37, that we can learn that his power was manifested, or that God's power was manifested. And at the end of the time, I, Nebuchadnezzar, lifted my eyes to heaven, and my understanding returned to me. And I blessed the Most High and praised and honored him. Let's see that now after he restored his blessing, the God's blessing, that he is manifesting and he is confessing that and honoring to God. He's not honoring himself. Many times we have a very bad experience. Last Sunday we were hearing or listening the how the man of God, Pastor Dave, was escaped or delivered from the accident. I have told my just 2-3 months before, I have terribly great, God has saved my life. I have shared my testimony to the mates over there in the Mount Zion house. I was traveling by train, just going to some meetings or somewhere, I can't remember. And I was sitting, because before 1 month, 2 months before, you have to reserve your seat or your berth in the train, so that you can get the reservation seat, or you can sit and sleep. The berth, the theater is three, just a bunk bed like that, and two is a little more spacious, but a little expensive. So anyways, I was sleeping in the theater AC train, and in the middle of the night, the train was passing very fast, very express, very running very fast, and there was bomb blast. There was serial bomb blast, 3-4 blast. Bomb blasted, so that's why many people they killed, and many trains overturned. But my compartment, and some even my compartment people also, they got hurt. But I was sleeping, like June, I remember. This is not because of my righteous act, but God saved His righteous people, His godly people, His those who are abide with the Lord, my dear brothers and sisters. Here we see that He confirms. This confirms the fact of a real social order. Verse 35, we can see that. So many verses are there where God is praising. Psalm chapter 63, verse 3 to 5. Psalm chapter 119, verse 164. The 7 times a day, David was praising to God. How many times you take examine yourself? How many times praising to God? Because of your salvation, because of you escaped from or got the job, nice job, or because of you got the nice, beautiful girl to get married, or husband, or beautiful house, cars, God. But here, he's praising to God, my brother. Anyway, so that verse 35, all the inhabitants of the earth are reputed as nothing. He does according to his will in the army of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth. No one can restrain his hand or say to him, what have you done? This confirms the fact of a real social order on the planet heaven. After the Antichrist, after the 7 rule, 3.5, the 7 years of rule, this type of things would be happen. That's I can read. So if we are abiding in the Lord, according to the Psalm chapter, John chapter 15, verse 7 says, if you are abide with me and my words abide in you, whatever you ask me, that I will give it, or it will be given to you. That is why you see that. So this is a kingdom. So he's anyway, he's praising to God, he's worshiping to God, he is personally acknowledged to God. My brothers, my sisters, have we recognized to God till now? Or are we going away from the Lord? Many times, God might have spoken to you by dreams, by vision. Many times, God has might have showed you by action in your life, in your family, or your parents, or in your children. But still, we are still silent, or still we are obedient to the Lord? Are we coming to the Lord? Or are we coming to the church to make just fellowship with someone else? Let's examine ourselves. Let's check ourselves that what is going on. So this is the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God would be happened like this. This is the foretold. This is the most example for our life. That is what happened in the life of Nebuchadnezzar. You are the king. 1 Peter 2:9 says that you are the priesthood. You are the royal priest generation. You are the priest. You are the royal. You are the place. You are the priest. But are we obeying? Are we preaching the word of God? Are we telling to the other like Daniel? Just I would like to tell you. This is the Bible says that the kingdom of God, that Jesus Christ was preaching every day and night about the kingdom. Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. John the Baptist was preaching the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God, that means we learned over here from Daniel chapter 4, that kingdom. The kingdom that right now God is, our heart is kingdom. If the God's word is accepting, believing, hearing, this is kingdom. God makes kingdom. I request you, everybody of here, that let your heart, surrender to God, His King, to God's kingdom. God's kingdom can come to you. God can be the ruler, and He will reign in your heart, my brothers, my sisters. Here we see that. I would like to Acts chapter 1, verse 3 says that he was preaching. Paul also, the kingdom of God, he was preaching. To whom he also presented himself alive after his suffering by many appellate proofs, being seen by them during 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. What did Paul preach? What are you preaching, or what are we preaching every day? The kingdom of God, or only heaven and earth, or repent only? So we are the God, so we should be perfect. We should be 30-fold, 60-fold, and 100-fold. God wants to be, according to Hebrews chapter 6, that God wants to see you, the perfectness from you. God wants to see your 100% fold from the word of God. God can teach us. God can teach us, my brother. So many verses are there according about the kingdom of God. Now, God wants to see, bring the 100% fold, 100-fold. Harvest. God wants to see your changes hearted. We were living like beast, but God wants to see that. God wants to restore His blessing and His kingdom through us. Praise God. So that's why let's praise to God. Let's not praise for ourselves. Whatever we are doing, let's praise. All the glory and honor and praise goes to the God, Heavenly Father. Thank you so much for giving me time, and so let's open. Let's stand up and let's pray together, and let's ask to God for His kingdom, that His kingdom can come to our heart, to our family. Let's stand up and let's close our eyes, and we'll pray for 1 minute. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Glory. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We praise you. Worship my God. Thank you, Jesus. Dear loving Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this day you have given us. We thank you so much once again for this word you have given to us, my God. Thank you so much that you have spoken to us, my God. We know that who you are. We know that your kingdom will be established on earth forever and evermore, my God. Lord, sometimes we are proud of our words and activities and our social work, charitable work, or anything, our family, our car, house, and anything, Lord. Lord, is all the things is belongs to you, that we know that. Please come by here, Lord. Come to this church. Come to this, all the people, those who are sitting over here, Lord, my God. Come to this congregation. You establish your kingdom over us, my God. In us, my God. We thank you so much for everything. We thank you so much. We love you, Jesus. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.